And welcome to The Watchman. Well, the Middle East is not exactly known as a peaceful, stable corner of the world, but it's never been more on fire than it is today. Think about it. In the past 2 years alone, we've seen the rise of ISIS, borders erased, a caliphate declared. We've seen the Iran nuclear deal, which guarantees that a major Middle East war is coming. In the summer of 2014, we saw a precursor to that war when Israel battled Hamas in Gaza once again. Meanwhile, Hezbollah has some 100,000 rockets and missiles aimed at every inch of Israel. And if all that weren't enough, we now have Russia entering the Middle East in a major way, increasing its military presence in Syria by the moment. Folks, recent history shows us very clearly that what happens in the Middle East does not stay in the Middle East. The events I just described are world-altering events, and they have all taken place since Passover 2014, when the first in a series of four blood moons appeared in the sky. We're now approaching the last of those blood moons. Could it be a signal that God is getting ready to move on the world stage? On this week's special edition of The Watchman, we sit down with Pastor John Hagee to discuss what these blood moons mean for America, for Israel, and for you. Pastor Hagee, of course, is author of the best-selling book, Four Blood Moons, and appears in the hit film of the same name. Now, in addition to blood moons, we also talked to Pastor about his latest bestseller, The Three Heavens, Angels, Demons, and What Lies Ahead. Folks, I just finished reading The Three Heavens. It is fascinating. That's coming up. But first, in case you haven't heard about the series of four blood moons that we're in the midst of right now, here's a brief report to get you up to speed. Take a look. It's called a tetrad, four total lunar eclipses appearing in close succession just a few months apart and turning the moon into an eerie blood-red color. These tetrads have been a rare occurrence throughout history, yet we are now in the midst of one. It began in April 2014 on the Jewish holiday of Passover, when the first blood moon appeared. Soon we'll see the final blood moon on September 28th during the Jewish Feast of Tabernacles. The final blood moon comes as a nuclear deal with the Iranian regime is being finalized, a deal that could lead to a Middle East war.
The day America turns its back on Israel will be the day God turns his back on America. And the day we validate this Iran nuclear deal as signed, sealed, and delivered will be the day we stick our finger in the eye of God.
Pastor John Hagee is author of the best-selling book, Four Blood Moons, and appears in a recent film of the same name. Hagee believes the current tetrad of blood moons is a sign from God to the world that something major is about to happen involving Israel, with Iran's drive towards a nuclear weapon being a possible trigger.
President Obama says this Iran deal is going to prevent war. Seems like it may be doing the opposite. Do you think we're heading towards another big Middle East war potentially?
What the United States of America has done in the Iran agreement is to guarantee war. Iran has been saying for years, we're going to wipe Israel off the map. They had the will to do it. Now that the Obama administration has paved the way for them to get a nuclear weapon, they've given Iran the power to do it.
Hagee notes that the three previous tetrads of blood moons, all falling on Jewish feast days, have coincided with major events for Israel and the Jewish people. In 1492, the Jews were expelled from Spain, and Columbus discovered America, which would become a safe haven for the Jewish people. In 1948, Israel was reborn as a nation, and in 1967, Israel recaptured Jerusalem during the Six-Day War. Blood moons are mentioned in Scripture, including in the book of Joel, the book of Revelation, and the book of Acts.
The prophet Joel writes the words, "And I, the Lord, will cause the sun not to give its light," that's a solar eclipse, "and the moon shall turn to blood before the great and notable day of the Lord." Genesis 1:14 said God is using the sun, moon, and stars to send signals to mankind. God used the stars to cause the Magi to find Jesus Christ. Joshua, when they were in the battle of the five kings, commanded the sun and the moon to stand still for almost a day.
Hagee believes the current tetrad of blood moons, coming during Jewish feast while Israel's enemies are on the march, is no coincidence.
The evidence is very clear scripturally that God controls the sun, the moon, and the stars, that God is sending us a signal through the sun, the moon, and the stars. The question is, are we listening?
Now that you have some background on this tetrad of blood moons, here's my interview with Pastor John Hagee from Cornerstone Church in San Antonio.
Well, Pastor, welcome. Great to have you back here on The Watchman.
I'm delighted to be back.
Yeah. Well, look, we are approaching the end of this tetrad of four blood moons. Can you tell us about some of the, I would say, earth-shaking events we've seen since the first blood moon, Passover 2014? What have we seen that's gotten us up to this point and the final blood moon?
I think the most crucial thing that we have seen is this American-Iran nuclear deal that is absolutely a disaster looking for a place to happen. We are allowing them to have their own military personnel give to us the intelligence about how they are guarding their own things. They are giving a 24-day notice before we come to inspect. They are getting $150 billion from the United States when the deal is signed. They will not use that money to build parks, hospitals, churches. They will use that money to fund Hamas and Hezbollah, who will attack Israel with it. So we have not a bad deal, we have a horrible deal. And the reason that this is so crucial for America is this: that we are dealing with Israel. Israel is the apple of God's eye. God said to Moses in Exodus 4, "Moses, I want you to give Pharaoh a message." And the message is, "Israel is my firstborn son. If you let him go, I will let you go. But if you not let him go, I will kill your firstborn, because Israel is my firstborn." There's a principle in the scripture that what you do to Israel, God will do to you. And if we as a nation are empowering Iran to wage war against Israel, if we are paving the way for a nuclear holocaust, if we are paving the way for terrorists to be equipped and trained to attack the Jewish people, and they most assuredly are going to use that money for that, God is going to allow terrorists to attack us. Things will happen in America that will make 9/11 pale by comparison, because there is that very simple Bible verse, "I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you." I have said many times and say again, the day America turns its back on Israel will be the day God turns his back on America.
Pastor, give us some scriptural. You and I talked about this last time we talked blood moons before the tetrad started. Give us some scriptural references to blood moons.
The blood moons are identified in Joel, the second chapter, verses 30 and 31. The prophet Joel writes the words, "And I, the Lord, will cause the sun not to give its light." That's a solar eclipse. "And the moon shall turn to blood before the great and notable day of the Lord." That's where I got the title for the book, "The Moon Will Turn to Blood." Jesus said in Luke 21 that when you see these signs, when you see the signs in the stars, the sun, the moon, lift up your heads and rejoice, your redemption draweth nigh. Those are the two major incidences, but the capacity of God to send messages to us with the sun, the moon, and the stars, our evidence begins at Genesis 1:14. Genesis 1:14 said, "And I have set lights in the heavens to be as signs and seasons." The word "signs" in Hebrew is oth, and it means signal. So Genesis 1:14 said God is using the sun, moon, and stars to send signals to mankind. If God is sending the signals, are we watching? David writes in the 19th chapter of Psalms, "The heavens declare the glory of the Lord. Day after day they speak, and in the night they bear witness. Therefore, all of that information is coming to us from the heavens. God used the stars to cause the Magi to find Jesus Christ. Joshua, when they were in the battle of the five kings, commanded the sun and the moon to stand still for almost a day. That would be almost 24 hours. So the evidence is very clear scripturally that God controls the sun, the moon, and the stars, that God is sending us a signal through the sun, the moon, and the stars. The question is, are we listening? And that's why I wrote the book, The Four Blood Moons.
And the subtitle of the book is Something is About to Change. This final blood moon coming, September 2015, very pivotal month, lots going on. Fasten our seatbelts, I guess, huh? Going forward, 2015, 2016.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. I have no doubt that when war begins in the Middle East this next time, it may first be a lesser war of a few weeks, but it will start escalating as a woman in childbirth, what the Bible says. And when those birth pains begin, they get more severe and closer together until the birth of the child. The wars in the Middle East are going to become more intense, more often, until it reaches the breakthrough stage and it is going to be beyond the ability of speech to express what's going to happen.
Up next, more from my interview with Pastor John Hagee, the three heavens, angels, demons, what lies ahead. You don't want to miss this. Stick around.
Pastor, one of the reasons I love your new book, The Three Heavens, is it is a book for these dark times. Angels, demons, spiritual warfare. Tell us why The Three Heavens is so timely today.
First, the biblical reality of three heavens. St. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, that I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I was taken into the third heaven. If there's a third heaven, logic says there's a heavens one and two. The Bible begins, in the beginning God created the heavens, plural, and the earth. That Hebrew word, heavens, is plural. So there is a heavens one, two, and three. The heavens one is that you see with your natural eye. The heavens declare the glory of the Lord. And the firmament, which is the evidence of what you can see. The second verse of Scripture concerning the sun, the moon, and the stars is that God has made it possible for us to know that there is a second heaven. The second heaven is where Satan has his throne. Satan, there was a revolution before Genesis 1 and 1, and he led a third of the angels down to rule the earth and its powers. He was given dominion over the earth. When he said to Jesus, in tempting him, said, power has been given to me. It actually was. He did have that power. It was given to him by God when it was cast out of the heavens. But he commands one third of the angels who are fallen angels, and from the second heaven commands the demon powers that are on the earth. There's a very powerful teaching in this book about demonology, how to recognize evil spirits, how to cast them out, how to control them, how to detect them. And with stories that are very, very, very graphic. The third heaven is where God Almighty sits on his throne and Jesus Christ stands at his right side. The third heaven and paradise are one and the same. Jesus said to the thief on the cross, this day shall you be with me in paradise. So paradise and the third heaven are one and the same.
You talk a lot about people who've almost died, who've seen a glimpse of heaven, who've come back, and what awaits us believers in the Lord Jesus beyond death, the great things that are coming. Talk about that a little bit.
The good news, when you come to the end of the book of Revelation, is that God Almighty destroys all of the enemies of Israel, that he himself sets himself up as King of Kings and Lord of Lords over the whole earth. The good news is that for every person who is righteous and dies in a state of grace, goes to the third heaven. I'm reminded of the story of my grandmother. She was my mother's mother. She was 88 years of age. She had been a nurse all of her adult life, and she was in the hospital, and the doctor said she's dying. And she was a large German woman and very strong-willed person. She spoke like George Patton. I mean, just she had that gear in her. Yeah. And my mother was sitting beside the bed praying for her mother, my grandmother. And my grandmother had been in a coma for several days. And my mother, telling me the story, said, suddenly, Grandmother Swick opened her eyes and looked straight at my mother and said, Veda, stop praying. Stop praying right now. Said, I'm getting to the other side, and I see Charlie, that's her husband, and I see Esther Gladys, that's her 10-year-old girl that drowned. And she said, and just about the time I get there, you pray, and I come back here. Stop praying. And my mother, dumbfounded, stopped praying, and in 2 minutes, my grandmother was on the other side.
Stick around for more with my interview with Pastor John Hagee on the Three Heavens.
Pastor, you have so many great stories like that in the Three Heavens, which to me are inspiring. And we always wonder, hey, what's on the other side? And my little ones, I have to confess, I have an 8-year-old and a 4-year-old. I've been telling them stories from the Three Heavens about little children.
Yes.
You personally know some of these families or who have almost died, who've seen angels, who've seen a glimpse of heaven and come back to tell about it.
It's the story of Jackson. Yeah. Jackson was 4 years of age. His dad worked at the hospital here in San Antonio. And they'd just put in a new swimming pool. And the man who built the pool said, don't let anybody in this water because we have heavy chlorination in the water. It'd be very damaging to your lungs. So the first day it's there, and they're all looking at it, and they go in to have supper, and the dad misses Jackson. And it dawns on him, oh no. And he ran out to the backyard, and Jackson was face down in the water, lifeless. He jumped in and pulled his boy out and started giving him CPR. No response whatsoever. He screamed for his wife to call 911. They were a considerable distance from the hospital. The ambulance came. Those people who came with the emergency medical unit gave Jackson CPR. No heartbeat, no sign of life. They drove to the Baptist Hospital, no heartbeat. No sign of life. The doctor was giving Jackson one final round of massive drugs, trying to stimulate him, and there was a very tiny heartbeat. For the next 14 or 15 days, Jackson was on the oscillator, and miraculously, I'll make a lengthy story short, miraculously, he survived, and he was thought to going to have to be weeks of rehabilitation and so forth. When they dismissed him, he jumped out of the bed, ran to the car, and went home. They got home, and his dad took him out to the swimming pool, said, do you remember what happened here? He said, yes, I drowned. And he said, well, were you afraid? He said, no. He said, Grandma came. His grandmother died when he was 2. He really didn't know who she was. He said, well, what does she say? And Jackson told her, and he used exactly the phrases and words that his grandmother would use, but he couldn't possibly know. Yeah. And the father said to Jackson, well, what happened then? He said, well, I went to heaven. He said, how'd you know it was heaven? He said, well, when I got there, he said, all of the streets are real shiny. That would be golden streets. Oh, yeah. And there were big houses everywhere. And he said, and then what happened? He said, I saw Jesus. He said, how do you know it was Jesus? He said, he told me it was Jesus. He said, he told me
the innocence of a child.
Yeah. And he said, well, what did his face look like? He said, you can't see his face. Said, it's so bright, you can't see it. He said, but he does, he is covered in blue. Says, the beautiful blue that's around him. And he said, well, what did Jesus say? He said, Jesus told me I was going to have to come back and live with you and Mama. And I opened my eyes in the hospital, and there you were. That is a story that is medically confirmed by doctors I know.
That's right. It's in the book. It's in the book.
Yeah. And he, when he opened his eyes, he said to his daddy, and 4 years old, said, I'll be fine. I'll be fine. And so he is. Heaven is a real place. It's for real. It's where the righteous go. It's where the word goodbye has never been spoken, where not one tear has ever been seen. It is the place of family reunions. It is the place of joy and celebration. Every moment that we are there, it's going to be worth it all when we see Jesus.
The Three Heavens, again, to me, is a very inspiring book. And my little ones were excited that I was coming down to interview you again, because they can't get enough of the stories of little Jackson and the other stories like that that are in the Three Heavens. And your firsthand accounts, I think, are riveting too. You've seen a lot of things in your years as a pastor, and a lot of your wisdom and firsthand accounts are in the book. So I encourage everyone to pick it up right away. Pastor, thank you so much.
Thank you, Eric.
Thanks for joining us this week on The Watchman, and thanks as always to my friend Pastor John Hagee for hosting us at Cornerstone Church in San Antonio. Again, folks, the books are Four Blood Moons and The Three Heavens. You can find them at Amazon.com and wherever books are sold from coast to coast. And also be sure to pick up the film Four Blood Moons. You can find that now on Netflix and Amazon.com. Pick them up. And until next week, God bless you, and remember, never hold your peace.